Speaker, sir, my esteemed colleagues in this newly constituted 18th Lok Sabha, I stand here on behalf of my party, the All India Trinamool Congress. कोई बात नहीं, वो मेरे एलओपी है, वो मेरे एलओपी है, वो ऑलरेडी मुझे सुन चुके हैं, वो मेरे एलओपी है. Honorable Speaker, sir, my esteemed colleagues, in this 18th Lok Sabha, I stand here on behalf of my party, the All India Trinamool Congress, to speak on the Honorable President's address. The last time I stood here, sir, the last time I stood here, I was not allowed to speak. I was not allowed to speak. आप लोगों ने अरे लेट मी फिनिश आई डिंपल लेट मी फिनिश गाइस
इग्नोर
लेट मी फिनिश एंड जितना जिसको जाना है प्लीज जाइए नो प्रॉब्लम द लास्ट टाइम आई स्टूड हियर आई वाज नॉट अलाउड टू स्पीक बट द रूलिंग पार्टी हैज पेड अ वेरी हैवी प्राइस फॉर थ्रॉटलिंग द वॉइस ऑफ वन एमपी मुझे बैठाने का चक्कर में जनता ने आपके 63 सदस्यों 63 जन को परमानेंटली बैठा दिया यू हैव गॉन डाउन फ्रॉम 303 टू 240 इन माय मेडन स्पीच इन द लोकसभा इन जून 2019 आई स्पोक ऑन द 7 साइंस ऑफ फैशिज्म दैट वर टेकिंग ओवर दिस कंट्री 5 इयर्स टू द डेट ऑन जून 27 2024 This house saw the unprecedented scene of the marshals welcoming the President of India, the Honorable President, with a sengol in their hand. The sengol is a symbol of the supreme authority of a monarch. It has no place in the temple of a constitutional democracy. But Honorable Speaker, sir, it is understandable why this happened. Because the BJP has still not understood that their 303 brute majority, their Raj Tantra, has been reduced to a 240 seat minority by the Lok Tantra. They are still living in the world of the Sengol. This sudden change reality, this new reality, is yet to sink in for the treasury benches and especially for the speech writers of the Honorable President's address. The speech that the Honorable President read out, she said, the people of India have elected a stable government with a clear majority. Please do not embarrass the office of the President by using poorly edited cut and paste versions of old speeches. This is not a stable government. It depends on multiple allies with a history of U-turns. It has not got a simple majority. The BJP is 32 short of 272. It is going to be a very hard landing for the Treasury benches, as was obvious today. This time, there are 234 warriors this time, firmly united, and we have walked through fire to walk through these doors, so you will not be able to shut us up this time the way you did last time. There are numerous statements in the Honorable President's address that defy even a tenuous link to truth and to reality. Like in my 2019 maiden speech when I spoke in 7 signs, today I have picked out 6 themes from the Honorable President's address and I will analyze how each of them is an exercise in fallacy and exercise in untruth. The address covers many issues, but I have chosen 6 themes. The first theme, the Northeast. The Honorable President's address says that the government has increased allocation for the Northeast by 4 times, has worked for increased and lasting peace in the area. Now, I have one question. Why is the word Manipur nowhere in the speech? Why do we refer to the generic Northeast? During the Lok Sabha campaign, the BJP, the ruling party, the Honorable Prime Minister mentioned many words beginning with the letter M. Musalman, Mullah, Madrasa, Mughal, Mutton, Machli, Mujra, Mangal Sutra, but not once did they mention Manipur. We don't need to act east. The government says we want to act east. We don't need you to act east. Look east, walk east, and most important, embrace east. I stand here for my brothers and sisters of Manipur, and I quote the revolutionary poet Pablo Neruda. One morning, the bonfires leapt out of the earth. One morning, the bonfires leapt out of the earth, devouring human beings. And from then on, the fire. From then on, blood. Come, see the blood on the streets. Come, see the blood in the streets. Please go to Manipur, see the blood in the streets. The second theme in the president's address, women empowerment. The speech says, women in our country have been demanding greater representation in the Lok Sabha and Vidhan Sabhas, and today they stand empowered by the Women's Reservation Act. This is a complete untruth. Firstly, you conveniently delayed reservation for women in parliament because you actually fear women. Yes. You fear Nari Shakti. Yes. You want their support, but you certainly don't want us here. The 17th Lok Sabha had 78 women, 14.3%. The 18th Lok Sabha, this Lok Sabha has only 74 women. Shit. 4 women less than last time, only 13.6%. The ruling party, the BJP, had called a special session to bring in the women's reservation bill. They have got a shameful 30 women MPs out of 240, only 12.5%. It is only Mamata Banerjee's Trinamool Congress that in 2019 had 37%, and even this time has got 38%. The president's address talks of a comprehensive campaign by the government to enrich and make 3 crore women Lakhpati Didis. All that we have seen so far is a far more comprehensive campaign to make 1 Arabpati Dada. I'm sure I don't need to take his name in this house. I'm sure we all know who we are talking about. The third theme, Kashmir. The address mentions that after decades of shutdowns and strikes, the Kashmir Valley has voted in an atmosphere of stability and security. But if abrogating Section 370 was such a good idea, why did the ruling party, the BJP, not even dare to put up candidates in the 3 valley seats of Anantnag, Baramulla and Srinagar? If 370 was such a big deal and you were going to campaign on the basis of 370, you did not even dare to fight the seats. The Kashmir Valley has voted in MPs who were against your 2019 decision. You downgraded Ladakh into a union territory. You told them it was a temporary move. Today, 5 years later, the Ladakhis are still waiting. They have not got back their statehood. You have not given them a legislature. You have not included them in the 6th schedule. You have not given their demand of 2 separate seats of Leh and Kargil. As a result, in the current Lok Sabha, the Ladakhis have relegated you to 3rd position in the Lok Sabha. You lost it. The fourth theme in the Honorable President's address, the Election Commission of India. The speech expresses gratitude to the ECI for conducting the largest election in the world. With all humility, with no intent to denigrate the office of what used to be the august constitutional body of this land, let us as members of this opposition put on record that we won in spite of the EC, not because of it. The commissioners, chosen by a government-dominated panel in willful disobedience of the Supreme Court, turned a deaf ear to the most egregious violations of the Model Code of Conduct by the ruling party, by the Honorable Prime Minister, with his hate-filled speeches and his divisive religion-based rhetoric. This country has been ashamed and disgusted by the language used against minorities during this campaign. This election will go down in history where an eager and compliant election commission turned a blind eye and a deaf ear against the excesses of the ruling party when the MCC was in effect. Opposition leaders were arrested, party accounts were frozen, ED and CBI even came into our election offices with impunity. Ultimately, the voters took charge and they said, "Bahut ho gaya." Enough is enough. The fifth theme, and here I have to commend the speech writer's very dark, almost macabre sense of humor. The Indian Railways, aviation and infrastructure. The address says that work on the Ahmedabad-Mumbai bullet train is going on at a fast pace, and Indian Railways is doing feasibility studies for bullet train corridors in the north, in the south, in the east of India. Now I'm going to ask the government a question. Why are you, Honorable Chairperson, is this a cruel joke? You are sanctioning 1,08,000 crores, 1,08,000 crores for one single Mumbai-Ahmedabad bullet train. A basic high-speed rail network costs 200 crores per kilometer. The Indian Railways is touting the Kavach anti-collision system. It's an automatic train protection system as the cheapest in the world. Says 50 lakhs per kilometer is the cost. The total rail tracks in India is roughly about 126,000 kilometers. So the cost of covering all of India with Kavach is going to be 63,000 crores. All of India's Kavach costs 63,000 and one single Ahmedabad Mumbai bullet train costs 1,08,000. Please look at the numbers. Last June in Balasore, three trains collided, 296 people died. The ministry said Kavach was not operational on that route. Last week, Kanchenjunga Express collided with a goods train in New Jalpaiguri. 10 people died. Again, the ministry said Kavach is not operational on the route. The Economic Times had a survey which said that the current level of funding, it will take 50 years for all of India to be covered under Kavach. And you're telling us about bullet trains. And please don't start shouting about what it was during Nehru's time. We don't know and we don't care. False equivalences cannot take the place of real body bags. The address mentions about how India is apparently the third largest domestic aviation hub of the world. In truth, India's airports have become domestic hazard hubs. First in Jabalpur, then in Delhi, then in Rajkot. Newly constructed airports have canopies falling down, killing people. The newly constructed Rampath in Ayodhya has had three cave-ins in the last week. The Pragati Maidan tunnel is flooded. The Atal Setu has developed cracks. The Ram temple's roof is leaking. This is exactly what happens when infrastructure is poorly planned and rushed in order for photo opportunities by the Supreme Leader. Yes. The sixth theme, competitive cooperative federalism. Honorable Chairperson, sir, the last decade saw the most brutal government-sponsored throttling of cooperative federalism that this country has ever seen. I speak for my own state of West Bengal. The center has withheld 7,000 crores in MGNREGA funds.
Shame.
17 lakh households have been deprived for work already done. It has held back 8,200 crores under the rural housing scheme, over 11 lakh houses sanctioned but not paid. Another 1,000 crores has been held back in pension and PMGSY, a total of 16,000 crores. When we went to meet the rural development minister, we were dragged out by the Delhi police and bundled into prison vans. Last week, as a delegation, we went to meet with Atishi of the AAP, who was in hunger strike. Look at what is happening in the AAP government in Delhi today. The Aam Aadmi is in power in Delhi. There was a 1994 water sharing agreement which mandated Haryana to release 613 million gallons of water per day to Delhi. Haryana is run by the BJP government and they have reneged on this agreement. They are releasing 100 million gallons less per day, as a result of which 28 lakh people in Delhi are having to go without water per day. This government's competitive cooperative federalism seems to be an exercise in how to compete on how to choke opposition-run states. भैया हमको बैठानो आप पे बहुत भारी पड़ा हम पे हमको मत बिठाइए बहुत भारी पड़ा आप पे बहुत भारी पड़ा The government spent the past 5 years.
Honourable Member, kindly address to the chair.
The government, please, the government spent the first 5 years in almost perfecting an elected autocracy. And by the end of 2023, this government had reached the pinnacle of their arrogance, where this parliamentary democracy was replaced by a monstrous super cult, the cult of the Supreme Leader, the non-biological leader born of the Paramatma, who stood in this house and proclaimed, Abke baar 400 paar, and ek akela kitno pe bhari pada. This was the turning point. This was the turning point when the destiny of the ruling party changed. Whether in Greek mythology, whether in Indian mythology, if you act with arrogance towards the gods, you will be punished. We have 33,000 gods in India. But in our democracy, the most supreme of them is the Ganadevata, the Lord of the people, and they have punished you. You may have formed the government again, but yours is a Pyrrhic victory, a victory which inflicts such a devastating toll on the victor that it is tantamount to a defeat. In Bengal, the Supreme Leader started his Vijay Sankalp Yatra on March 1st. Yeah. In the constituency of Arambagh, then came to Krishnanagar, then came to Barasat, ended on May 29th in Calcutta. मेरे ऊपर तो विशेष कृपा की उन्होंने दो दो बार आए. The BJP lost all these seats. The Honorable Prime Minister did 23 campaign meetings in Bengal and lost in 20 seats. In Maharashtra, the Honorable Prime Minister campaigned in 18 seats. The NDA lost in 15 of them. Ek akela, kitno pe bhari pada. In Punjab, he campaigned in Hoshiarpur, in Jalandhar, in Patiala, in Gurdaspur. The BJP all lost all the four seats. Ek akela, kitno pe bhari pada. In Rajasthan, he campaigned at Banswara with the most disgraceful references to Muslims. In outright violation of the law, the EC kept quiet. Not only did the BJP lose Banswara by over 2 lakh votes, the BJP, which had won 25 on 25 in 2019 and won the state government only months ago, came down to 14 seats. Ek akela, kitno pe bhari pada. Three states, Uttar Pradesh, Maharashtra, and Bengal, account for 170 seats. That is exactly one-third of India. The BJP won in only 54 of them. Ek akela, kitno pe bhari pada. In 2019, the Prime Minister, the Honorable Prime Minister, had taunted the now leader of the opposition by saying that he must have used a microscope to find that one single seat in India where the minority were in majority. Honorable Chairperson, sir, it is so ironic that today the majority needed no microscope to turn the BJP into a minority. Jahan jahan bhi majority hai, wahi aap hi minority ban gaye. आप तो घुस घुस के मारने वाले थे ना, इस बार तो जनता ने घुस घुस के मार दिया. The treasury benches have always claimed that the opposition lacked in hard work and in merit. We are all part of a parivarvad. We are dynasts. Whereas they are proud to be part of a meritocracy. They are proud to be part of a Modi ka parivar. How ironic is it today that 20 ministers in the Union Cabinet are dynasts? How ironic is it that the Honorable Prime Minister has to take to social media himself to tell people that no, it is not Modi ka parivar, it is NDA, the Nitish Naidu Dependent Alliance. In January, the Honorable Prime Minister consecrated the unfinished Ram Temple in Ayodhya. He said he was tasked with the divine duty of bringing Ram Lalla home. The Ram Mandir was going to ensure that not only would the BJP cross 400 seats, but that this government would last 1,000 years. The last time in history that we heard of a 1,000-year vision was during the Third Reich. This was the second time that we've heard of it. But then ultimately, Lord Ram said, stop, not in my name. Oti dorpe hoto lanka, too much arrogance, too much pride, caused you to lose the kingdom of Lanka. The BJP lost in Ayodhya, Faizabad, where the temple is. It lost in Banda Chitrakoot, where Lord Ram meditated. It lost in Shravasti, where the son of the Honorable Prime Minister's ex-secretary said, my father has built the temple, campaigned in his name, you lost there. All the seats around Ayodhya, Basti, Sultanpur, Ambedkar Nagar, the BJP lost. Ye tim logo ke naam japo mein pehle sa aaram nahi. ये तुम लोगों के नाम जपों में पहले सा आराम नहीं, जबरदस्ती के जय श्री राम में सब कुछ है पर राम नहीं. जबरदस्ती के जय श्री राम में सब कुछ है पर राम नहीं. टुडे इन इंडिया देर आर टू टाइप्स ऑफ लीडर्स, दोज ऑफ अस हु कम बाय द वोटिंग मशीन एंड देन देर आर मेनी हु कम बाय द वॉशिंग मशीन. देर आर स्टिल पीपल हु से wait, wait, you don't know Modi ji. Wait 6 months and see. The BJP will get 300 members. To them I say, no, this will not happen this time. Because every potential turncoat will have to choose between temporary greed of fear and between permanently becoming politically irrelevant. So you can offer a temporary offer of a ministry, you can accept a temporary settlement of an existing trumped-up CBI or ED case, and you can switch parties. But when you go back to the electorate will punish you. Most turncoats have been punished by the electorate. Also this time, India has very large, solid bloc components. So Congress has 100 seats. SP has 37 seats. Trinamool has 29 seats. DMK has 22 seats. NCP and UPTA have 17 seats. So this is not a ragtag bunch of members that you can lure away. This is a solid bloc. So yes, it's a question of time. But the question is not whether they will get 300. The question is when people will join us and we will cross 272. Yay! The ruling party's politics have always been along the lines of religious hate and ethnic divisiveness. But even at the height of their power, when they got 303 seats, one out of two Hindus had not voted for the BJP. This time, even in their core Hindi heartland, their core voters have deserted them. The Muslims in India, over 250 of them, called infiltrators, called terrorists in the land of their birth, waited silently, patiently, and bided their time. And in one voice during this election, in every state, they stood up and they told the government, and I quote the poet Puneet Sharma, Hindustan se mera seedha rishta hai. Tum kaun ho be? Tum kaun ho be? Kyu batlao tumko kitna gehra hai? The Dalits, whom the BJP paid lip service to for so many years, realized that even the talk of 400 seats meant that Baba Saheb Ambedkar's constitution was in danger, and they deserted the party. The Marathas, whom the BJP coalition had tried so desperately to woo, realized that their promises were worth nothing. The BJP and its allies lost 7 out of 8 seats in Marathwada. The Jats, the careers of their youth at risk with this ill-conceived Agniveer scheme, their farming livelihoods threatened, their female wrestlers manhandled, they vented their anger at the ballot box. Ultimately, it was the BJP's policies of exclusion, not inclusion. You wanted to exclude everybody, and that was your undoing. You didn't need Muslims. You trampled on Dalits. You ignored farmers. You ignored Jats. You marginalized Kashmiris. Well, they consolidated their voice during this election pan-India, and today they don't need you. That's the message they've given you during this election. Ye desh hi apna hasil hai, jahan Ram Prasad bhi bismil hai. Mitti ko kaise baatoge? Sabka hi khoon to shamil hai. That's what they said. You can't divide us. You can't do it anymore. This new India, this new frame of reference, is going to be very hard for a lot of interest groups. Perhaps the first casualty is the legacy media. The Godi media was its own worst victim. The brown-nosing TV anchors and online trolls lied, spread fake information, amplified the government's propaganda. So-called sophologists, who actually had printing contracts from the government of India, were on TV 24/7 acting like the election was a done deal. There was no need for voting. The BJP had already won. Media moguls organized conclaves where they prostrated themselves before the Vishwa Guru. Anchors used staged interviews and set up scripts. In short, the media had lost all credibility. So when you asked the people during surveys which way they voted, they didn't trust you and they didn't tell you the truth, which is why you got it wrong. Ram Kamal Jha, the editor of the Indian Express, remarked that some media owners were so comfortable on their knees that it hurts to stand up. To them we say, please stay where you are. There is a new generation of journalists in India today with spine, with integrity, and with courage. A media you have done your best to silence with fake cases and attempts and censorship, but they have survived and they will thrive in the digital space. I will also touch upon another pillar in our democracy, the judiciary. 2 days ago, the Honorable Chief Justice of India, while on a visit to Calcutta, remarked that judges were not deities. They are here to dispense justice with compassion. Just as one can't be partly pregnant, you either are or you're not. Justice and democracy too must be absolute. They cannot partly be in effect. The retirement age for High Court justices is 62, and the retirement age for Supreme Court judges is 65. Now, this has unfortunately contributed to High Court judges kowtowing to the Supreme Court collegium and to the government for a last-minute elevation to be able to serve for 3 more years and then qualify for further sinecures, such as the head of the Lokpal, the head of the National Human Rights Commission, chairman of various tribunals. It has come to such a state that opposition leaders framed in politically motivated cases are denied and bail and denied justice simply because judges are even scared to touch their case for fear of offending the government. Today, I say, the poorest people in India who have perhaps the most to lose from offending the government in power, they have shown spine and risen to the occasion. Your lords and ladyships, heed thy inner voice, have a spine, rise to the occasion. 7 months ago, on the 8th of December, this house was transformed into a Kuru Sabha, presided over by a blind Dhritarashtra, where Dushasan Darbaris made every attempt to disrobe Draupadi. The ethics committee that voted to recommend my expulsion on the 9th of November, if they voted 6-4, had 10 members and one chairperson. Of the 5 Lok Sabha members from the BJP, 4 have not returned to the house. The chairperson, a BJP member, has also not returned. The Congress turncoat from Punjab who voted against has also not returned. The BJP lady MP from Maharashtra, who started the debate in the House on behalf of the BJP, has also lost. Much like Lord Krishna protected Draupadi, the people of Krishnagar have protected me. In the last year, a lot of people look at me and say, oh, Mahua, you must have lost a lot. You lost your membership. You lost your house. And by the way, I also lost my uterus due to a surgery. But you know what I gained? I gained what Rahulji said, the freedom from fear. I do not fear you. I will see the end of you. We will see the end of you. Your ED, your CBI, your income tax, your trolls, your media, your bought out judges, nobody can scare us. The people of India are patient. They will wait patiently for this government to fall. And I hope that whoever writes the next speech for the Honorable President of India will give her the respect and the honor due by not filling it with falsity. This government has dishonored the office of the president by giving her a script that is full of lies. We wait, and the people of India wait, for the restoration of her honor and for the honor of her august office. It is in this hope that I bow my head to the holiest of our books in its 75th year of adoption. Hail the Constitution, Jai Shongbidhan. Thank you. Jai.